Good evening, Reading and Berks County, and welcome to the Berks Inter-Cultural Alliance show for February. I'm your host, John Morgan, and lately pretty much over the last year, we've been doing series on different faiths and religions. What we're trying to do as an interfaith, interracial, intercultural organization is bring information about different belief systems to the people of Berks County. The idea being the more you know about other belief systems in your own, maybe the more understanding and tolerant you are of them. This evening, my guest is a Buddhist. Welcome, John Sellers.
Thank you, John. Glad to be here.
John, I think, is a familiar face to BCTV viewers. He's been on BCTV many times over the years. John brought Buddha with him tonight.
Yes, a Buddha figure. And if you're a viewer and not familiar with Buddhism, then you may have seen a figure like this sitting in a meditation posture. And this is not something that Buddhists worship, although we may bow in the direction of the altar from time to time. It's a likeness of a person who's practiced meditation. He learned the value of essentially being quiet and at peace, and not so easy for us in a world where we may have debts, we have wars, we have illness, we have a lot of suffering. And so why did this man, the historical Buddha, take up serious meditation, and why do we do it? And there are many other practices besides sitting meditation, but that's why I brought the figure along. You've probably heard of Buddhism, but maybe you've seen a figure like this. My parents kept a likeness of Buddha called Ho Te, Chinese figures, okay. Sort of a very fat but very jolly man, male figure, Chinese, with his arms up in the air. You find these wooden carvings, and they kept it by my bedside, actually, from early childhood. I began to realize that there were similarities between Christianity and Buddhism. And
such as?
Well, the parable of the Good Samaritan, that the Good Samaritan didn't found someone beaten down in a ditch and possibly dying and robbed and actually naked on a dark and dangerous road to Jericho. And he didn't ask, what's your politics? wasn't concerned whether it was a man or a woman. It was a person in need. And one of the things about Buddhism is responding spontaneously to those in need. And we don't necessarily get into their politics or their wealth or their class or their skin color or any of that. Buddhism is a way, as a result of many practices, to drop the preconceptions and notions we have about what things are and actually see what the needs are and respond to them directly. And that's a key point, because it's easy to get off into knowing things that really we really don't know, making assumptions about people and about ourselves and all of that.
Mm-hmm. Buddhism isn't a religion per se compared to a lot of, you know, we did Islam, Judaism, and you know, could be covering a lot of other faiths coming up, but there's no creator. There's an afterlife if you get into the reincarnation part of it and all. But there's no deity, there's no God.
That's right.
It's more of a belief system, a way of living your life.
Well, it views an essential aspect of the universe is infinite creativity. And we are integrally, as not only as humans, but as all beings, integrally potentially just as creative. That we are the universe, but there's no entity, conceptual entity of a single individual or say a man-like figure that at some point in the time past created the universe and either interacts or doesn't interact or somewhere in between. That's not a concept that's followed in Buddhist practice.
And a lot of, if it's from my very elementary reading and research, the concept of things and property. This is mine, that's yours, doesn't really exist in Buddhism.
Well, I think as one perhaps wakes up, and that's what the root of the word bud means, B-U-D in Sanskrit, it means to wake up.
Okay.
When we wake up, we see that the conventional distinctions, like ownership, for example,
right.
and owning private property, many Native Americans were aghast. They were stunned.
They knew the concept of personal property.
That's right. Air is for everyone. Water is for everyone. Land is for everyone. What do you mean drawing lines around it and defending it at the point of a musket or a knife to the death? Mm. They couldn't understand that.
Yeah, it was a totally alien concept to Native Americans when Europeans came here.
Well, it was, and this delineation of property and rights that adhere to it is a historical fact.
Mm.
But it wasn't everywhere in the world,
right?
And it still isn't everywhere in the world. So, go ahead. Yeah, you're right. That's true.
So, and that seems to be one of the tenets of Buddhism. A lot of people, think of Buddhism as something maybe mystical, spiritual. Something alien to them that they don't really know much about, they don't understand. But there are many aspects of Buddhism that are deeply rooted in a culture. Things like the concept of karma, the attainment of nirvana, reincarnation.
Well, Buddhism has its roots in India, and it was, in some respects, a reaction against certain beliefs in Hinduism. There's a radical equality about Buddhism that all beings are fundamentally equal. And that means men and women, for example, are equal. It took many, many centuries within Buddhism for women to reach the level of let's say, teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And here in the United States, I might say within the Zen sect, there are actually more women teachers, Zen teachers, than there are men.
And you're primarily a Zen Buddhist.
Zen Buddhist. So, but the notion of karma in one particular sect of Buddhism, Tibetan Buddhism, is on the mind almost constantly. The notion that how we live now will influence a future life all the way up to full Buddhahood. That way of looking at the world is not shared by all Buddhists, and Zen Buddhists don't really see that we're bound by anything that's happened in the past. In fact, the notion of a linear past or anything that survives as a soul that's subject to rebirth in one form or another is that's considered to be, from the Zen point of view, I think, a mentation, you might say, a notion. But they adhere to it many very strictly and with a lot of discipline in Tibet. So there are differences with Buddhism.
Yeah. One difference is that differences in Buddhism, they aren't at war with each other the way they are, say, in Christianity or Islam.
I would say in general that's true. We've seen war between Buddhists and Muslims in Sri Lanka and now in Burma. But that's over living space and things like that. But in general,
it's not like they're fighting over their ideologies, their faith beliefs.
I'd say generally that's true. Yeah. That's generally true.
The attainment of nirvana. This is the ultimate goal of Buddhism, correct?
That probably applies to Theravadan Buddhism, the Buddhism of the elders, which found welcome roots in the south of India, but Northern School Buddhism, the so-called Mahayana, Maha means great, Yana means vehicle, greater vehicle Buddhism, teaches that attainment can happen on the streets of Reading. It's not something that's a fixed state. It can be a momentary state.
Mm-hmm.
Buddhahood is acting in a compassionate, appropriate way as the needs arise, without bringing your stash of prejudice, of greed, anger, and delusion. It's realizing that whatever is in need is our need. That pain and suffering is our pain and suffering also. We're not, there's no fundamental difference between you and me, and really for that matter, no fundamental difference between, say, John Morgan and a cat or a sheep. Right. That's a pretty radical view.
Well, that's because within Buddhism, there are six different stages of attainment, and one of them is the animal state.
That is a widely held view also in many of the sects of Buddhism, that we go through various stages and finally attain full Buddhahood. Zen is a little different because realization of one's essential nature can happen in a moment, and it can happen in a flash. But for most people, it takes a lot of work. And so, again, the notion of stepwise stages is a very old teaching, and it's closely followed, but it's not accepted in Zen. Okay. Zen throws out just about everything that's held in Western culture. Zen is a bit more radical. Go ahead.
Well, let's talk about Zen then. Tell me more about Zen.
The first thing I'd like the viewers to realize is that they can try it, and then they can learn about sitting quietly, because Zen does involve a good bit of sitting meditation. It also involves some chanting. It involves a teaching that form here is only emptiness, emptiness only form. And emptiness doesn't mean nothingness. Mm. It's more like emptying, that we don't rigidly attach to anything.
Yeah. Now, I practice transcendental meditation. Okay. I have for a long time.
Yeah.
So I have a pretty good understanding of what you're talking about here, but maybe our average viewer doesn't. Meditation is a very central part of Buddhism. Talk some about that before we get into that. You mentioned the importance of quiet time and stuff. I do want to mention that one of the things the Intercultural Alliance does and sponsors it twice a year is a whole day of silence and meditation here at Albright College. And we'll be doing that again, I believe, it's September 11th. That information will be on our website, berksinterculturalalliance.org. So go on.
Well, yeah, and the best one of the ways of learning about Zen is actually to do it, and it doesn't cost anything. The Zen group meets Sunday mornings between 8 and 10 here on the Albright College campus, and on Linden Street, right near 13th Street, and so just off 13th. Anyhow, there is a website if people want to actually try it, and I recommend it. It's a horse of a different color, but there are other things going on in Buddhism besides those. There's a Tibetan following here in Berks County. Okay. There's a Pure Land sect now that is up in above Huff's Church, 130 acre estate. It was the Mensch Retreat Center, United Church of Christ facility for decades, and now it's been bought by a Pure Land sect of Buddhists.
And they're going to be a significant presence here in Berks County, correct?
Well, they are already, I think, in many ways. Right now, though, their services are held in Vietnamese and in Chinese, but not yet in English.
Okay.
But it's a beautiful facility, and people are welcome to visit. Mm.
When I meditate and I get into a deep meditative state, it's really interesting. It's like you purge everything from your mind, and it's almost like you're floating, kind of sensation that I get.
Well, and attention, the regularity of breathing, the brain waves actually change. Mm-hmm. That's been documented pretty well.
And you can feel that as you meditate.
Absolutely, you can. The important thing is to carry this into day-to-day, moment-to-moment life. And so that we can see things more clearly, we can respond appropriately to the moment, that we don't lash out or act out from deep conditioning, from the culture, from our parents, from life experience, from the way we think we look or who we are. All of that stuff goes. It goes with the help of a teacher, and this is another major difference. In Zen, serious Zen practice, you're working with a teacher on a regular basis, in many cases for years. You're not bound to do that. You're free to drop out of it. That's is very different because you're not. There's no minister or preacher telling you what's what or what you should or shouldn't do. It's you're working with a teacher who challenges you.
Right. We have a home viewer. Hello?
Hello.
Hi, go ahead.
How are you? I appreciate your show. I had a friend who was a practicing Buddhist, and one of the things he enlightened me to was ties in with politics is the four pillars as far as grassroots democracy, social economic justice, environmental wisdom, and nonviolence. And I didn't catch the very first few minutes of your show if you covered that or not.
We haven't yet.
No, but one of the fundamental ideas of Zen, the freedom is based on not equality and equanimity. And those are crucially important, and that's a pillar of democracy, to say the least. We are inherently absolutely equal. And that's true between, in a fundamental sense, if realization is broad enough and free enough, you realize that your essential nature is not really different from that of a parakeet or a rabbit. But we treat each other very differently. We honor each other, we bow to each other, and as a matter of a momentary experience. And so we treat each other with kindness, with respect, with patience, with attention.
With dignity.
And with dignity and with attention. We don't have preconceptions about, we realize that all beings are really the full universe right in front of us. That's very different from thinking it's, we're going to go through the gates of heaven or we're going to go through the gates of hell and tough luck if you're there. It's fundamentally different.
Does that answer your question, viewer? Okay. Well, thank you very much for calling in. And if anyone else has any questions, don't hesitate to call in. I also mentioned that John will be back with us next month, and we'll discuss Buddhism in a little more detail a little further next month.
I hope people who are viewing now will bring friends in and ask some questions. There's plenty to say about it, but Buddhism's here in Reading, and it's in Berks County. And one of the things I think is wonderful about Berks is, as you know, that the Intercultural Alliance is all about getting different religions together, because we do have values in common.
Yes.
There's no question about that. And
it's all about finding common ground.
Yeah.
And working together.
And everyone's welcome. Everybody in the whole region is welcome, whatever their language background or particular religious experience has been. Mm. Nobody's trying to turn people into a different religion.
No. Our mission is one of education with our organization. And, this show here on Berks Community Television is our main vehicle for that, but we also do forums in the community about different issues, especially around race. And, you're a member of a religious faith community in Berks County. Do you like to participate with us and bring your faith belief system to our show? Please contact me. My email is paprogressive@gmail.com. And I'd like to hear from some Sikhs and some other different people of faith communities in Berks County and Reading.
I would too. Well, there's one point I would like to make if you're still viewing, and that is that the historical Buddha has the fundamental question, I think, that drove him to serious meditation was looking into the problem of suffering. Mm. The causes of suffering, the fact of suffering, and what to do about suffering, and how to free oneself and help all beings free themselves from suffering, and many, many are. And that's the fundamental point. It's not about...
And attainment, nirvana, is the elimination of this suffering.
That's right. It's the extinction of it, and the full extinction means it's not coming back.
Exactly.
not yes. coming back. And that's available to us, right. And that's what Buddhists believe.
Okay. And the word for that is dukkha?
Well, dukkha is a term that, a right. Sanskrit term kind that refers to...
encompasses something. All of that.
What really turned the light on for me was okay. a year in Vietnam.
Okay.
Because I saw the kind of crazy suffering people mm-hmm. get into, and I was involved in it. And it really shocked me to the roots to realize how easy it is to get sucked into the damage that we can inflict on each other. So, and I'm really glad that I found a way that attracted me seriously.
Well, it's interesting when you talk about that is, you know, in the reference to war and conflict, it's so much war and conflict of human history has been over religions. You know, my God is greater than your God, or your God isn't legitimate. Mm-hmm. There's really none of that in the Buddhist faith.
People get so attached to systems of belief, and their families get involved in it, and their whole history and their ancestry gets committed to all of this, and they'll mm-hmm. kill rather than let go of some of these rigid beliefs.
Right. And letting go of a lot of that advances you more towards the attainment of nirvana, really, when
oh,
you
sure.
think about
and
it.
And it's right here. It's right here. Nirvana and Zen, this very place is the lotus land.
Okay.
So, well.
Well, there is a website for the Berks County Zen Buddhists. I don't know if they've put that up yet, but if there it is right there. Thank you. And we thank John for coming in this evening and spending half an hour with us, and he'll be back next month, and we'll talk more about Buddhism then. It's a very complex, interesting subject. So we thank you for tuning in, and this has been the Berks Inter-Cultural Alliance. I'm your host, John Morgan. Good evening.